Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
On behalf of the Board of Commissioners, I'd like to welcome each and every one of you to tonight's meeting, primarily centered on our discussion of the 2008-2009 budget. Before we begin our deliberations, I'd like to ask Commissioner Sutton to lead us in the invocation.
If we can take a moment, please. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for another beautiful day. Thank you for the beautiful spring that we have had. Please be with us as we go into summer and help us not to have the same conditions that we had last summer with the drought. Be with us as we deliberate tonight's business, the county's business for the upcoming fiscal year. Help us understand that a decision has to be made. Help us all realize that we're all residents of our county and we must understand how the process works, whether we agree or not at times. Please be with us in our personal and our professional lives. Please bless us. Help us understand that an association with you means more than definitely not having one with you. Amen.
Next is our public comment section. And we have two individuals scheduled to or signed up to speak. Now, this is in addition to the public comments that we have on the budget. First signed up is Mr. John Jordan of Saxon Hall. John?
Welcome, John.
Thank you. I really, these folks out here really need to know what good folk we have in front of us. I write the commissioners and call them if I have a concern that I think will help them help the county government. I called Larry last Thursday. He called me back on Friday, knowing bankers work till 6 o'clock on Friday. And I didn't know I had his cell phone, but he answered, and he said, I can't hear you. Let me step outside. I said, where
John, then you don't have to tell everything.
This shows the commitment these folks make. And he was at the beach. He was standing in line to eat.
What a tough life, right?
And he got out of line to talk to one of his constituents, and I appreciate it very much. I would not have done it. I would have said, I'll call you back.
His wife saved his place in line.
I wear two hats tonight, and one a citizen of Southern Alamance County forever, and I'm chairman of the Saxon Hall Community Chest, and that's why I'm here tonight. We had a fantastic proposal from your Brian Haygood, your county manager, the head of Parks and Recreation, and I want to bring y'all to that point. It pertains to a multi-purpose building that could be built at the B. Everett Jordan, or would be built at the B. Everett Jordan Elementary School, which sits on 30 acres of land. The ball field is, there's two ball fields there, and my father donated the land and built a building in 1952, and it gave it to the Saxon Hall Community Chest, which has operated this, we call it the Saxon Hall Community Center, and we renamed it in honor of Buddy and Bessie Collins several years ago, so it's the Collins Community Center now. And we have provided recreation for the youth and senior citizens of Southern Alamance County up until this year. The mill, when we were operating a textile mill, Sellers Manufacturing Company, provided all the funds for the director, the maintenance, the upkeep, and the repairs, the insurance, up until 78. We sold the mills to Dixie Yarns, who provided funds a little while and quit. And the Sacramento Community Chest needed money to operate the building, the community center. And we put on a Redbud Festival to raise money. And that went for 13 years. We netted about $5,000 to $10,000, and that was not enough to maintain the center. 3 years ago, you, the commissioners, had a study commission to find out the needs of the recreational needs of the county. And as you know, Southern Alamance County is probably your fastest growing section of the county. And you said, yes, 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 we should do something. The Sacramento Community Chest Board said, we will give you the center if y'all will operate it. The county came down and looked at it and said, we don't want it. It would cost too much to bring it up to code. And so we struggled along for three more years. But you did take the two ball fields and have done a fantastic, good job operating the two ball fields under the county's recreation department. So when we were faced with closing the center or doing something, we came back to the recreation department, Brian Haygood, and he said, again, they sent out some people from the county to look at the building, and they said, nope, don't want your building, but we'll take your land and use it as park and recreation. So he says, we think that if you built a multi-purpose building next to the school, it would serve two purposes. The school would use it when the school wants it, anytime the school wants it, by day or by night. And other than that, then the county could use it when the school did not want it. I said, man, this is fantastic, a win-win situation. And so he is, y'all will be talking about this in your budget, and that's why I'm here. And since it's being used or could be used by the county and the school, this might be something you would want to approach the school system to see if they would also like to help, and that's up to y'all. As a concerned citizen, I will be willing to chair a committee to raise $100,000 to help this project become a reality if y'all will do your part.
Okay. Very generous of you, Mr. Jordan. Thank you. Okay, Sam Mosier has signed up to speak.
Mr. Sharp, I'll not speak at this time. Maybe later if that's okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, having no one else to sign up for public comments, we'll close this section and move on to the next item of business, which is a resolution opposing the realignment of the county line. Mr. Bateman, who is the city amendment attorney.
Welcome.
Thank you.
How you doing?
Good, thank you. I do come with my capacity as city attorney for the City Council of Mebane and to deliver to the board a resolution unanimously adopted by the City Council in response to complaints, not necessarily complaints, but concerns raised by the citizens, primarily of 9th Street within the City of Mebane, who came to our board and pleaded for our assistance in approaching both Orange and Alamance counties with the proposition that when the new line is established, and we do believe that we do need an established line because it leaves a lot of people in limbo. So we're not opposed to establishing a new line, but we do believe that the established families that live in Mebane should be allowed to remain in Alamance County, and they feel so very strongly. It is my understanding that the actual location of the line, while historically or scientifically may be in a given location, if the counties agree, that location can be altered. And we're asking both counties to agree to honor the line that has been observed for at least the last 30 years within Mebane. And we leave you with a petition and with a resolution. And it is our hope that at some point in time, the county commissioners will see fit to have a public hearing on the issue to allow the citizens of Mebane themselves to make their concerns known. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for allowing me this time.
Thank you, Mr. Bates. This process is just beginning, and it will undoubtedly be tweaked as the process goes along. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, next, I think we come to the item of business that most people are here tonight, and that's the consideration of the 208-209 budget ordinance. And we begin that process tonight with a public hearing for anyone who would like to speak on that matter. We would ask that speakers will limit their comments to a couple of minutes if they could. So I will begin on the left side over here. We'll start with those standing. Does anyone standing like to speak on the rear row, the last row? Would anybody like to speak? Next row. Yes, ma'am. If you would state your name.
Hello, I'm Allison Gantz, and I'm the Alamance Citizens for Education Executive Director. And I'm here tonight on behalf of the community and its voice. As the recent proposal of our county manager does allow for our schools to maintain its current level of service, it is also important that we look to the future and find ways to develop an economic status in the state. One of the most important factors in looking at an economic state is an education system. As you know, any company that is looking to expand its resources considers education in one of its top three criteria. And I currently know that Alamance County does not rank high in this category. Resources, involvement, and effort to change are needed to move business to the forefront. Let me ask you a question. As businessmen and women, do you expect your business to operate year after year with the same expenses? My guess is no. Business, unfortunately, with the cost of living, costs more each and every year. Now consider this. Surely, as we know, the cost of living rises. In order for a business to grow and prosper, we must recognize that investing in one's business only makes sense. So I ask you, why is Alamance County not investing in its most valuable resource, our children? We can no longer sit back and do what we've always done, because the old adage is, we get what we always get. And that is not good enough. And things are changing. This county sits in a prime location for attracting new businesses and industry. But we don't attract. And many current businesses, their employees are living in other counties and commuting in. And one of the biggest reasons is they look at education and the system in the county. Is our school system doing a good job? Absolutely. With the resources that it is given, it is frugal and it is making good choices. But our county can do better. That lies in your hands. We want you to open your ears and hear the community. The time has come, and I can say with certainty that the citizens of this county are and will demand better. As the executive director of ACE, I can assure you that parents and teachers and business leaders and even more individuals are wanting more. I am thankful that Alamance Burlington School System didn't have to fight for the essentials this year. But should we be happy with the bare minimums? The answer is a resounding no. Keeping in mind that today's students are tomorrow's leaders, teachers, elected officials, and caregivers. Education must be a top priority for any community that desires economic growth. A thriving community can only exist when everyone works together and find ways to lead into tomorrow's global world. I challenge you to listen. Let's not accuse, but listen. And start the wind of change. For the economic profit of investing in education is far more reaching than today. ACE, Your voice for the community urges you to approve the county manager's recommendation for this year, but with the expectation that you will look to the future and find ways to help provide more to our educational system in Alamance County for the future. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Anybody else on the neck? Okay.
I guess. Commissioners, I come before you tonight, and I appreciate Allison bringing that point to you about the educational system here. But also, I have a question about what we're doing this year on the fund balance. I've studied your book here a little bit, and it looks like it's kind of a pattern going on, and I'm just curious as to what can be done about it, and I'm sure you guys are going to discuss it before the night's over, because it looks like we're taking money out of our fund balance this year to cover cost. And of course, I'm a taxpayer, and I'd hate to see you raise taxes, but we've got to figure out some way here to balance these budgets. And I know from the February meeting, when the audit came about, she did caution you guys about the overusage of the fund balance and the concerns there from the auditor of that. So I do want to see our county pay attention to that. I don't want to have to do what I did in 2004 and have to pay 5.25 cents more when the taxes come next year. Thanks.
Thank you, Ms. Boss. Anyone else on the next to the last row? Okay. Second row, front.
Hi, my name is Angela Kalo, and I'm a resident of Alamance County. Most of what I was going to say has already been said by Allison, particularly the link between good education and good economic development. But I want to add one point in that she didn't say. I am supportive of you raising my taxes if it means that our children will get a better education in Alamance County. That is not something that I have a problem with, and I believe there are a lot of other people who feel the same way as I do, that giving that to our kids, that giving them a good basis, not only so they can get a good job when they grow up and bring business to Alamance County, but just because children deserve to have a love of learning, and they deserve to have good schools that help foster that. It's something that if you don't give them that, they miss out so much in life, and so they deserve that. I just wanted to say also that I think that this board understands that importance. I know many of your parents and grandparents, and you have children in your lives, and I know that these are things that you want for them as well. So please, when you're considering what you're doing with your budget, please think about that. It's about economic development. It's about helping our kids learn. It's about all these different things, and I want you to remember the kids in your own lives when you're thinking about what you want to do with our education budget. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Kayla. Anyone else on the second row?
I'm Mary Irwin. I'm probably starting to sound like an old record myself, but anyway, I'm a parent with two boys in the school system, and I just want to reiterate again what these two have said and ask you to please raise my taxes if that's what it's going to take to get our school system funded the way it needs to be funded. I want to say that I think it's shameful that we rank 111th out of 115 school systems in what we spend on our per pupil expenditure. And I think I'm right in saying that our per capita income in this county is 36th out of 100. And those two numbers don't jive to me. I think we have the ability to pay for good schools here. And I just ask you to please consider funding schools, raising the teacher supplement. Thank you.
First row here. Oh, excuse me.
Good evening. My name is Helen Leopold, and I'm a resident of Alamance County. I have three children who attend the Alamance County schools. More importantly, I work for one of the employers in town as well. I'm here tonight to talk to you a little bit about the economic value of investing in education. Mr. Lashley, you were recently quoted as saying that when ABSS builds a world-class school system, then you would be willing to pay for it.
If you read that somewhere,
in the Times News,
never been said.
That was said in the Times News after the school system initially proposed.
If you come here to bash me, you're asking for problems.
I'm not here to bash you, sir. I'm here to point out the value of why we do need to invest in our educational system.
Let me tell all of the teachers that's here tonight to force us to raise the people's taxes. I'm not going to vote to raise people's taxes. To give a school system that's behind the quality of what they should be producing, and that's students. And the only thing the county is responsible for is building the schools and maintaining them. And we're giving a third of our budget for the county taxpayers for the schools, and we don't have to do that.
Let me tell you something, sir. Our schools rank 111th.
Bill, let's let the
citizens.
Let's let the citizens.
I'm not here to intimidate you, sir. I'm sorry you're feeling that way, because that's not what I'm here to do.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am.
Bill,
let the citizens speak.
She brought my name up.
But we'll have our turn. Go ahead, ma'am.
Our schools currently rank, as Allison pointed out, 111 out of 115 of school systems in the state of North Carolina in terms of county level funding.
Forgive me. I know we're going to have our time. But we have got to state the facts. Our ranking per pupil locally is 46th. What you are constantly, the people are constantly putting out there, is this ranking right here of federal, state and local money, which is 106. It's 106 because the state and the federal appropriation is low. Our per pupil county appropriation is rated 46th. Now, I don't mind listening to details, but I just want the facts.
Well, what is our average per pupil? Our average per pupil spending is what, sir? Since you seem to have the numbers in front of you.
I have them. I'll assure you I have them. 46th.
What is the actual dollars?
According to this, $1,477.94
per pupil. What is the total funding then per student? Because what happens
is
the federal and state funding is a metric off of the county level funding. And that's something you have to take into consideration.
I'm not going to put up with any distortions myself. We'll have our time, but I'll assure you that ranking is not accurate, and that is a distortion that is constantly put out there. We are ranked above. Your own lobby group out of Raleigh, Public School Forum, they couldn't be more pro-funding for the schools. And they have a chart. The latest chart shows that our ability to pay is ranked like 47th. In the state, based on our evaluations, our incomes, so forth and so on, our ability. We are ranked above our ability by a couple of rankings in what we're actually doing, the actual effort. It's here. And this constant reference to the fact that we're 100-something in local per pupil money is not accurate. It's not even close.
Well, if you look at the total funding per student, on average for the state, $7,200.
Right.
Ours is about $1,200 less than that per funding.
You stated that we were 100-something in local per pupil funding, and that is not even close.
I said county level funding.
And that's not accurate.
School systems.
That's not accurate.
Okay, so we're 106.
No, we're not. We're 46.
106 when you add all the elements that go towards funding education.
Federal, state, and local.
Okay, and the federal and the state.
Local is local. Federal is federal. I don't understand why people can't understand that.
The state is a metric off of the states.
The truth
told. We got, there's statistics that shows all different ways, so just go ahead and carry on, man.
It's very enlightening to see you gentlemen show your true colors, is all I can say. At any rate, our statistics show that we lag the state average total per pupil funding by $1,200. We lag the national average by more than $2,500. We look at our school system across, we have a 29% dropout rate.
Do you know the statistics of a dropout, the likelihood of that dropout to commit a felony crime within the first year of dropping out of high school? It's staggering. Do you have that too, Mr. Sutton?
I'm sorry.
Forget it.
Well, I heard
in any case,
you don't
it's
need to be
staggering. Well, you've
me.
Been sarcastic with me.
I'm stating facts.
So it is staggering. We can choose to house an inmate for a year, or we can choose to educate a child for the year. I would argue with you that it is far cheaper to educate that child, to give our children a chance in this county, give them more of a chance than what this current county commissioner Slate has been willing to do so in the past. Now is the time to invest in our education. Now is the time to speak up for our children. And I beg that you would look deep in your heart and find the ability to do so.
Thank you, ma'am. Everybody on the first row here. Yes, ma'am.
Hi. Good evening. I have never been to one of your meetings before. It sounds like I picked a really interesting place to start. And I need to let you all know that my comments are not very rehearsed. My name is Cindy Bennett. I am a citizen of Alamance County. I am the mother of three. And I'm missing my boys' Cub Scout graduation up to Weebelows to be here today. This is a very important issue to me. There is lots of lingo that I don't know, so I won't try to get into that. I'll just try to just make the points that I have. I am obviously very interested in education. I have three kids who are in the elementary school age. And I have a husband who was educated in Alamance County through the Alamance Burlington school system. He left there. He met me in medical school. We got married. We moved around, and we came back here. And why did we come back here? Because we wanted to be close to our family and because this is a wonderful place to be. This is a beautiful county. This is a wonderful area. This is a wonderful location. You can talk about being midway from the beach to the mountains, but it's also right on a corridor of incredible growth and incredible progress. I also want my kids to get a wonderful, wonderful education in this wonderful place. I've heard a lot of information from a lot of different places, so I got online myself to try to educate myself on some things. I've heard the numbers, for instance, the number of that are per pupil expenditure from all sources, as I understand it, is 106th in the state. But I wanted to educate myself on exactly what does this mean? How many people are we talking about? How much money are we talking about? So forth. So I got online to learn a few things. What I found is that, according to the Census Bureau, in Alamance County, 23.8% of the population is under the age of 18. And if you subtract out the kids under the age of 5, it's nice that they did that for us online, you come up with 17.3% of Alamance County's population that is school age, ages 5 to 17. So we are not talking about a small number of people in Alamance County. We're talking about people who can't vote, and I'm not trying to get political here, but we are talking about a very large number of people. As a contrast, 13.7% of Alamance County's population is over the age of 65. Every different demographic in our county has different needs, but the need for that 17.3% of our population is a very good, strong, solid education. Now, I'm married to somebody who was raised in this school, brought up in this school system, and got a very good education. I tried to find out a little more about the people in Alamance County, other people in Alamance County, and you'll have to forgive me because I only had so much time to spend online. But I did pull up, I was looking through the Census Bureau statistics, and what I found is that 76.5% of our population over the age of 25 finished high school. And this may lead a little bit into Helen's statistic of dropout rates. I did not find a set dropout rate, but I did find that 76.5% of our population did not finish high school. And this made me think about the businesses that might want to locate here and might want to hire people, hire professionals to come work for them. So I tried to get a comparison along the I-40 corridor of high school graduates. What I found is that in Orange County, 87.6% have graduated from high school. From Guilford County, 83%. Durham County, 83%. Chatham County, 78%. We're a little bit below that. It may be that we've got some work that we really need to do. The other number that I've heard is that number that's in the $1,200 to $1,400 range. That's the amount per child that we spend on education. And just as a working mother, or a mother who did work, I've priced out daycare, and I say with all respect that $1,200 wouldn't get me 3 months of daycare from the hours of 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. for one of my children. And we somehow are stretching that out to 9 months and getting our kids an education from that. That's good, but maybe we need more. If we want to increase our, if we want to make our education system better, maybe we need to put more money into it. And I'm not saying just hurl money at it. I'm saying put money into it with a very good target. But I think it has to start with the money. Now, I also looked at our funding and where it comes from. In this county, 66% of our education money comes from the state, 10% from federal, and 24.5% of our money is local. And this is about the time my ride showed up and I had to get here, but I pulled up really quickly one nearby county, Orange County, which is dear to my heart. 37% of the funding in Orange County for their schools is local. For us, it's 24.5%. I, like other people who have already spoken, would be happy to pay more in taxes to make our number closer to that 37.5%. If we're not getting it from the state and we're not getting it from the feds, I don't want to sit around and wish that we had it. I'd rather create it. That's all I have to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Mills. Anybody on the front row? Anybody on this side at all? Okay, anyone standing in the back row there? Okay, the last row, anybody like to speak?
Hi, good evening. My name is Michelle Grabiel, and I too am a resident of Alamance County and very much for our educational system here. I'm not going to say a whole lot because I think it really has been said, but I'm just going to say, why should we settle for 46%? At all, why not just go for being number one and doing what we need to get there as a county? You know, I'm on my way out. My last one's a senior this year, but I'm not done and stuff because I know the type of people that we want to be in this county and that we want to educate in this county. We have, you know, the type of people that are going to be, you know, serving us at McDonald's or the people that are going to be, you know, working with us when we go to Brookwood or whatever. We want these people to be educated. So I'm just asking you to give the school board and those people what they need to do their jobs. Please don't cut their budget anymore. Please give them what they need. We know that you're doing the best that you can on a lot of issues, but why settle for less than being number one? And I think that we can do that here in this county and stuff. So I'm just asking you guys, to, ladies, just to please, you know, make sure that you're keeping that in mind and for all the different departments and things that are going on. But we can be better than what we are. And I thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Reagan.
Anybody else on the rear row, Mr. Jordan?
I'm a small real estate developer. And the lady that would like to move to Orange County, I have some land for you. And if you believe me, you do not want to live in Orange County.
Sir, I lived in Orange County for 2 years.
I have some land for sale.
Sam.
I'm Sam Moser. Thank you for the opportunity to speak. I want to compliment all you commissioners on the challenge you have before you and the way you handle all the issues. I'm probably going to feel like Kurt Busch. I think he's a race driver that gets booed when he leaves the racetrack with the winning check. But I've got just a slightly different twist. I know everyone here is interested in our young children and their education. But I heard Ms. Gant say that our students of today, which this will be true, are our leaders of tomorrow, and let's raise our taxes. But also we need to please keep in mind our students of today are going to be the taxpayers of tomorrow. And the more tax burden we want to put on the county, our students of today are going to have that burden for the rest of their life. We want the best education we can get, but no one has mentioned discipline. And I hear from a lot of teachers that discipline can be is a problem in our schools, which causes a lack of better education. So it's a little different twist, but one thing I would like to ask our commissioners, I'm a senior citizen. I've been working for, 50 years at least and paying taxes, and no one has spoke up in favor of senior citizens who are on a fixed income. But again, we want quality education. We want good teachers, and I think we have that in Alamance County. But keep in mind, if we keep raising taxes and saying we're doing it for our kids, we're putting the tax burden on our kids for later on in life. I just want to mention hurriedly, Papa John's restaurant, I don't know if any of you read this article in the paper, but they go to the trouble to print the students in Alamance County, list their names, who made the A honor roll. And this was the May issue of this year. I counted them up. I think it's like nearly 1,800 students who made A honor roll in Alamance County. So, and some of these also made it in November of 07. I read through the November. I would like to read all these names, but I know time won't permit it. But I am so proud of these students who worked hard and made the A honor roll. And they didn't achieve this because of a lack of funds in Alamance County. So just please keep in mind, I think discipline, parental involvement, and good teacher support is what helped these students make an A honor roll. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, the middle row. Anyone on the middle row or the back row? Okay, the back row.
Thank you for your time. Mm-hmm. I'd like to add something to what Mr. Jordan has brought up for the current funding for this year. Last year, I am a coach for Alamance County as a volunteer. Last year, the Eli Whitney Gym was shut down for a brief period, and if you could have seen the looks on those kids' faces when I had to tell them, I don't know where we're going to coach. I don't know where we're practicing. We ended up, you guys put together, the athletic director, I think it was Dan Morvac, he put it together where we were actually practicing over at Southern High School and Southern Middle, but that was only half court most of the time. And if anybody has any young kids, I've got three boys at home right now that are all in school and on that Papa John's list, by the way, that I'm extremely proud of. Tell 5- and 6-year-olds, or to try to teach 5- and 6-year-olds how to play basketball on a half court is extremely difficult. So that multi-purpose building would mean a lot, not to mention I've been coaching, because Eli Whitney can only offer a half court, I've been raising money to rent the Saxbaha Community Center, which I found out we can't use that next year. So why can't we be like the way Sylvan is handled and E.M. Holt? We use their gym. The school gets to use it. It's really nice, to be quite honest with you. And if anybody here is from the Beaver Jordan Elementary School, you know how hot it gets in that gym that they have right now when we have a big seminar or award ceremony. So consider it. Southern Alamance County needs it.
Thank you, sir.
Scott Myers.
Okay, anybody else on the last row? Yes, ma'am.
Well, first of all, I'm not against the school, not against the children. But I am against raising the taxes. And if they need money, I still say they should get it from that other fund that they have, like them incentives they give to bring companies in here. If they've got the money to give outsiders, then I feel like they should help schools and things, but I am against raising the taxes. Because I'm not for paying outside rich companies to come in here, because they don't help, as far as I'm concerned, they don't help Alamance County all that much. They usually bring their own contractors to do the work that they do and their building and all that stuff. And I feel like if they're going to give the incentives to these outside companies, they should be mandatory to hire our local people, our local contractors and things. And but I just don't think they should raise our taxes now. I mean, there's people here in Alamance County that have to make a decision. Am I going to eat today, or am I going to buy my medicine? And I'm referring to prescription drugs, not illegal stuff. And so people is taxed to death. Elderly people, they can't hardly pay their taxes as it is. I live off limited income. The Lord's been good to me. He supplies my needs. But I just don't think they should raise taxes right now.
Okay.
They should. I don't say they should never raise taxes, but the way the economy is now and things like that, I just don't feel like they should raise them right now. That's just the way I feel.
Yeah, and I don't think we have any plans to raise taxes, Ms. Bowman.
I'm Joyce right. Glenda Bowman, right. And that's my name. Right. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay. Anybody else on the back row? Okay, the middle row there.
Hello, I'm Brooke Barnett, and I'm a Burlington resident. And I'd just like to address quickly 3 points that were just made by the past few speakers that have come up. The idea of discipline in the schools and parental involvement, and also the economic times, if I could, and I'll be brief about them. One key with the discipline in the schools is the class size, and that is an economic issue. That is a funding issue. And there's a lot of studies that can show you that discipline problems are greatly reduced with smaller class sizes. So these things are connected to the way the school is funded. The issue of parental involvement can also be an economic issue. Some schools in this county have had great success with family nights, with getting parents involved in ways that you bring in some child care, you bring in some food, you get people in and get them invested in their children's education. That also is an economic issue. The reality is some parents will not be involved in their children's education, but our county has to educate them. And that's what compulsory education is about. So as much as we want parents to be involved, and we ought to strive to have parents involved, we still have to educate the children of parents who are not involved. So we have to find some way for that to not be the only response that we have, knowing that we will not get 100% parental involvement in a public school system. And the last comment is on the economy. I know everyone is thinking about an economic downturn. Some people are using the R word of recession. I'm not an economist. I'm not going to say whether we're in a recession or not. But we know people are feeling tight times, right? Everybody that buys gas knows that people are feeling tight times, or if you're in a grocery store, you know that. I would like to suggest to you, though, it is still short-sighted to underfund education during an economic downturn, and let me just give you a couple of reasons why. Ms. Gant already brought up the idea of recruitment and retaining a solid workforce in Alamance County. The idea of stellar public schools is one reason that people decide to stay in a county and come to a county. It's an indicator of quality of life. And people can look at the report cards and the funding, no matter how you do the numbers, and see a very big difference between two counties. And then our county in the middle of those. And if you're thinking about living in any of these places, those things are going to matter to you. Property values are tied to quality schools. Several multi-year studies have shown that educational reform and economic performance are indivisible. The idea that counties fare well during economic downturns and reconstructions when they have solid school systems. And there are a lot of studies, statewide studies done in nonpartisan ways that can show you this, and I would be more than happy to share this with any of you who'd like to look at these. We also know from a lot of research the things that do help students: low student-teacher ratio, highly qualified teachers, low turnover in administration and teachers, outreach programs for at-risk students, social worker presence in the schools. These are things we know do help students, do get us to that higher quality of education that everybody in the room seems to want to have, but they do have a cost associated with them. So I would like to argue to you that it's not our advantage to shortchange the kids in the county, particularly during an economic downturn, because these things will come back to haunt us in ways that have nothing to do with education. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else on the second row? Yes, sir.
Good afternoon. Good evening, I guess. My name is Peter Felton. I'm an Elon resident.
I don't work for the schools. I know most of the people who've spoken don't work for the schools. But I have one child in the schools, another on his way into the schools soon. And I want to raise just 3 points related to what's been said so far. First, men care about schools just like women. You might not get that sense, but it's true. Second point is that, as far as I can tell, the County Commission has 2 things to do with schools. One has to do with funding, and I support additional funding for schools. That's my second point. The third is your political leaders in this county. What you say matters. I've lived in this county for 3 years. I don't hear the County Commission as a group or as individuals talking about the value of good schools, how essential it is that we have some of the best schools in the state. When I hear you talking about education, I hear problems, I hear expense, I hear negative, and I wish you would use your political bully pulpits, which you have, for good purpose to advocate for the best schools, even when we can't spend to have the best schools.
Anyone else on the middle row? Okay, the first row here. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Linda Dale, and I'm here on behalf of two reasons. I'm the co-chair for Voice, which is Voices of Individual Children Everywhere, and as a mom of 3 children. I have 3 beautiful children in the Southern Alamance zone, and I don't have statistics for you. I just have a mom with a heart for my children and the educators. I'm in the schools a lot, and believe it or not, I'm in the high school a lot. They allow me in there, believe it or not. I'm on the leadership team at Southern Alamance High School, and I get to hear from the teachers firsthand of what their needs are and what's going on in their lives. And the big piece that I hear, there's lots of pieces, discipline being one, and they're doing the best that they can with what they have, is technology. We have graduation project coming up that every child has to have a graduation project. They don't have the technology in the schools to be able to handle this, and it's something that they have to do. And I feel for those children who do not have a computer and cannot do these things at home. And with this upcoming school year, they will have to have graduation projects to be completed. It's mandatory. They don't have the facilities to be able to do that. Every teacher is trying to go to these computer labs, and they're already all full. Not to mention, they're so old, they cannot get things to download. It's a big problem. But they're too frugal. They are very frugal, not too frugal. They are very frugal, and they use the money that they have to the nth degree. I can see that for myself being in there. My concern is for the teachers. I feel like we train these teachers because we're a great school system, but they go somewhere else because the money's better somewhere else. We have wonderful teachers, and especially at Southern High, they have such a heart for those children, and I don't want them to go anywhere else because we can't give them the money they deserve. The next thing I want to talk about is, and I'm sorry, guys, I have to harp on Southern, the need for the new assistant principal there. I don't know if y'all have ever been out there when the classes are changing, but it's like a herd of cattle. It's very scary. I try not to be there then. There are so many students trying to go from one point to another, and it's almost impossible. I don't know if y'all have looked at the numbers, and I'm not giving statistics. I just wanted you to know there are 1,347 children in a 900 school per student capita. It was built in the 60s. It wasn't built for here and now. So please give them, if you could see it in your heart, please give them their assistant principal. They need that extra pair of eyes. It's a very open school, and you know they need to be able to see what's going on. They really do. I really appreciate you allowing me to talk. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else on the front row?
Chairman, I'm Mike Davis, board. I want to make it real brief. You guys have gotten waterlogged with everything you've heard, and I just want to say a couple of things. We're competing. We're competing, like Linda said, with other counties. We're competing with what they're doing. And some of that things, there's probably some really good things they're doing, and there's a lot of good things that they can probably improve upon. But a couple of things I'd like to say. The 1% that we're talking about, I think, is a real positive movement. I think that's a status quo movement. I think we ought to consider something. Several years ago, there was a movement. I'll talk a little bit about history for my brief moment. There was a merging of the Burlington City Schools and the Alamance County School Systems. I think that was a great initiative. I don't know where it came from. You guys probably had some input in that change. I don't know how many years ago that was, but it was a long time ago. That was a positive move in a good direction. That's been a long time since something has impacted that. I think we now have a superintendent that I've been told is a solid competitor, if you will, or a qualified competitor, or excuse me, not competitor, but qualified in his position as our new superintendent. We need to not only empower him and support him, but give him the tools he needs to back that up. And I think that's a big thing to think about when we're looking at what we do. Sheriff Johnson's here somewhere. And when he took over a few years ago and we elected as a body or as a county to put him in office, he did a lot of positive things. We not just gave him his support, we empowered him to go do the things he needed to do. Let's empower our superintendent to do the same thing. Thank you.
Mr. Isley. Chairman Sharp, commissioners, thank you. I'm Lee Isley and I'm from Burlington. I got to see the news right before I came over. And I hate to say the B word. Guilford County has had $1.1 billion in bonds since 2000. $1.1 billion. If those aren't serviced by 2012, that's $34 per citizen, per household. We're willing to talk about a 1% increase on supplement. So they're not even on an even playing ground with Guilford County or Orange County. Supplement alone. We can skew statistics, numbers if we want to. Percentage, 106, 111, whatever we want. Let's just talk about the supplement. Can we not get on the even playing ground so we can keep quality teachers in our county? I ask you that. I urge you to think about that. Guilford County's beating the pants off. If I were a company relocating to this area, I'd go to Guilford County, not Alamance. I expect we have Alamance County citizens with kids in Guilford County schools. You see the Greensboro Day School bus in front of the bowling alley every single morning. We're taking kids out of our schools to go to private schools and paying good money. It's not a money issue with a lot of those people. It is for the average citizen. I'm not for tax increases. Believe you me, I don't want more tax increases. But we are penalizing our future citizens. You won't see it. I probably won't see what we're going to do by not supporting these school systems properly. This will be outfall 20 years, 30 years from now. We're already behind. What's it going to be like in 20 or 30 years? I urge you to take careful consideration, not only this year, but moving forward with our school budgets. Do like Mike Davis said, we supported the sheriff. Look what he has done. We have a great superintendent in place. Let's not handcuff him and keep him from doing his job.
Anyone else on this side? Anyone else in the whole room? Okay, if not, the public hearing now is closed. And we'll ask for comments from any member of the board who would like to speak.
I'd like to speak.
Okay.
I've been hearing the need for schools since I was a small kid, and it's true. All the needs that everybody has spoken about tonight is justifiable. But there's only so much money that is available for schools. And we gave the schools a 15% increase last year. We're giving them over a 10% increase this year. But the majority of the money, if it's a shortfall, it's coming from the state. The county is doing all it's supposed to do and all it's required to do, and we're giving a third of our budget, like I said before, we're giving a third of our budget from the taxpayers as a gift to the schools. And I don't mind voting to do that, but there's only so much money that the taxpayers should be asked to contribute. And if this may sound ugly, and if you want to pay more taxes, I'm going to make a motion that we set up a fund, a special fund, where all of you people that want to give taxes, want your taxes increased, to give it to this fund, where it can go directly to the schools. And I'll make a motion that we do that.
Any other commissioner like to?
Yeah, I'd like to. You know, I'm sorry that we get into a debate about it. Number one, I don't skew numbers. Let me tell you that right now. I do my homework, and I can. It's my turn now. Okay. All right. Well, I don't skew them. I'll assure you. And to compare us to Guilford in a success versus non-success scenario in a capital arena, and insinuate that they're so much in favor of public schools over us because of their $1 billion indebtedness, they're in debt because they didn't build schools when they should have. We built schools when we should have. We owe 60-some million dollars in schools, school bond indebtedness. If we approve, and I'm going to support the next referendum for a new high school if we can get everything timed right when we feel like we need it. But with a new high school, our school bond indebtedness will probably go over $100 million. Now, you're going to compare $100 million to $1 billion, and they're only three times our size, and just put relative analysis on that. I mean, they are so far behind on their capital program, that's why they owe $1 billion. You know, we've supported every bond referendum that's come along for schools. I'm proud of our capital program. The numbers of students that we've got in mobile classrooms versus the state average is one half. The last figure I saw was 10% of the students in this state were in mobile classrooms. We're roughly at 5%. And I don't believe that's because of an inadequacy. You know, that's what we're mainly charged with. We're charged with the capital program, and I think we've got a good one in this state. The citizens of this county have approved bond referendums, and we've endorsed them and allowed them to go to the ballot. Now, as far as Guilford County's per pupil money versus ours and what the success ratio is, I was stunned, and I hate, you know, I wasn't planning on bringing all this out tonight. You know, it's amazing that none of the school system is here tonight. Is anybody in here from the school system? I'm sorry.
School board meeting tonight.
Okay, but they could have postponed it for this. And
you could have postponed yours for
it's my understanding that they are happy with what's been proposed. So, you know, I wonder why they're happy and others might not be. But the thing that was alarming with me, with all the money that's put into Guilford County and their per pupil expenditures on the 7 end of grade test in 2007 on the DPI's own website, Alamance County Burlington School System passes them barely in end of grade testing in 7 courses. Seven out of seven. We beat them in all 7 comparisons. So per pupil money didn't get their ratios up as you might think. Sure, there's some top, you know, excellent, you know, Grimsley High School. I mean, I'm over there, Northwest Guilford and so forth. I'm very familiar with their system. I'm over there practically every day. But money has not generated across the board the success that you would have thought would be the case. Now, here's what disturbs me. If you look at the ability to pay across this state of all the counties, that's in this analogy here. I didn't bring the chart. This is an old chart. But in the public school form, there are 7 other school systems other than us that is in the general vicinity of us as far as student population and ability to pay. 7. They have roughly the same number of students, give or take 2,000, and property reevaluations, incomes, median incomes, and so forth. If you compare those 7 school systems to ours, there are 7 end-of-grade tests. It's on DPI's own website. If you look at all 7 and the 7 tests that are involved, there's 49 potential matchups. 49. Us against them in each individual matchup. Out of 49, we only win 6 of them. 6 out of 49. Now, that's pathetic. Now, we're not losing by just a percentile point in a lot of those matchups. In the vast majority of those matchups, we're getting our fannies kicked by 5, 8, and 10 percentile points. Okay? If it wasn't for Randolph County, we would have only won 2.
Randolph County, there was four that we won and two others. Now, I would say to you, we've got to have results with what money is put into the system. I've looked at these end-of-grade testing now for test results for 2 years, and we've gone from 13 out of 56 victories when they had more, I think they had at that point, eight end-of-grade testing. Yeah, eight. And now they're in 2007, they were down to seven. We were winning 13 out of 56 comparisons, and now we're down to six out of 49. The way I look at it, the results just aren't there. And again, we're getting beat by people that are getting roughly the same amount of money per pupil that we're putting into our system. I don't have any objection with putting more money into education. Again, our ranking is about one ranking above our ability. Our actual effort is one ranking above, roughly, our true ability. I don't mind raising that effort. But at the same time, I've got to ask for results. There's no excuse in us getting our fannies kicked in end-of-grade testing in that percentile of comparisons. I don't care how you cut it.
Influx of the Hispanic population.
That was brought up, you know, last time I discussed this. These other counties have minorities. And I think it is, we should be beyond the point of blaming it on minorities. I heard that.
I'm just asking.
Yeah. We should be beyond that point. The high school, I would concede to you that at elementary and middle school that the influx on that immigration is causing is probably affecting elementary and middle school scores, but I dare say that in high school it's a drop in the bucket versus what the other two levels are.
And yeah, I'm
always available, but you know, and I don't mean any hostility. The best days of my life were public education. But I just don't like somebody telling me that we're ranked a certain ranking when we're not even close to that. We're not even close to 106th.
And other factors, as in what does the state pay them?
Right, exactly. And so when you say local per pupil is just that, not federal and state.
Now, well, we do rank lower because of the fact we have such a young workforce.
Okay, and I'd like to bring something out about that. I've heard that. I think the professor from Elon mentioned that to me. Aren't you a professor, Dylan? Right. I think he and I, he alluded to that in a conversation that we had. Yes, it's very possible that you don't get, of course, I did ask the school system for a full explanation of why the federal and state rankings were as low, and they didn't get back with me. And that was about a week and a half ago. Okay. It's my understanding that that is possible, you know, that is a variable.
Well, it is
there.
A variable because right. If you have a longer set of term teachers, then your expenditures are going to be larger, but that's okay.
But I would contend that, you know, young blood coming in from freshly educated students should be invigorating versus a lack of experience and lack of quality. The insinuation there is that a young teacher is not able to teach my child or my grandson the way somebody who's been there 30 years. I'm not sure I would agree with that.
Well, let's look at your job the first year as well as you've done it over the past 15
years. Well, I raised Cain from the day I got here. So. But anyway, God bless all of you, and I'm trying to keep an open mind. I want a true, fair debate, and I don't think I've distorted a single thing I've said tonight.
Can I say one other thing?
Yes.
One good comparison is the supplement. So it does remove all these things about ability to pay and other kinds of things because it is the percentage base, which you can compare more easily. And you see that at the teacher level, but you really see that at the administration level, too. And I don't think people are arguing that it benefits a county to have a bunch of new first-year principals. And there's no research that suggests that that's good. So the idea of the leadership in these schools and having some time to understand the school and be effective leaders is another piece of this. So we're talking about the teacher supplement, but also the administrative part of it, too. And those numbers are easy to see because they're percentages across every single system.
I'd like to add something, if it's okay. I was a teacher for 37 years. I feel your pain. I know what you're saying. Someone over here talked about the history of what happened between when we merged.
And that, it was me.
Yeah. I remember it well, but I couldn't tell you a date.
How long ago was it?
I was thinking 96, but I wasn't sure, and I didn't want to be wrong. That was a lot of debate at that time on merging the system. I lived in the city of Burlington. I taught in the county. I refused to pay the tax for the city of Burlington. I made my spouse do that, and I took the county tax because I didn't want to pay the supplement for the teachers in the city system. I just didn't think that was right. But I don't know that that may be a route that we need to go, something to consider, and I'm just tossing it out. I'm not saying to do it. I'm just tossing it out as a thought. Burlington City Schools was a model across this country, not just this state. It was a model across this country. They had everything they needed. I was in the county schools. I did get called by the city schools, but I loved where I was. I loved the kids. I'm sorry, you southern folks, but I was in the western zone, and I absolutely loved it. They had it, and we were like the stepchild. And sometimes we got what was left over, if we got anything at all. A lot of promises were made at that time to merge for the people, to merge the two systems. The condition was that the merged system would be at the same level as the current Burlington City Schools. That didn't happen. And some of us remember it well. And it certainly should be a goal that we have. I don't think we can get there that quickly. The students were coming out. We worked ourselves silly in the county schools, I can tell you that. Did the best we could. We had great kids. We had great parents. I agree with you, parents need to be involved. And I think that's a big secret. Somewhere they lose the route between that kid performing in the elementary schools and sometimes in the middle school. And then they forget where the high school is unless it's a ball game, you know. We will keep in mind the school system and doing what we can to do better, but the times are tough.
Can I just mention, were the languages lost in the middle schools in that merger? Is that true? Did the language, there's no language in the middle school in Alamance County, no Spanish, no French?
I believe it was.
They were not lost at merger. They were lost as principals made choices of where to allocate their funding, whether it's for a classroom teacher or for a special ed teacher.
And I know in the high school level, it depended on kids signing up for a course, if you had enough kids signed up for a course. And I know at Weston, we did lose like Latin teachers and German teachers and so forth, which was a terrible shame.
So maybe the zero language in middle school is a statistic we can all agree on.
I know it is.
We did equal the funding level. When the school systems were merged, Burlington City was like $800-some per pupil. County was down below 700, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, definitely there was a gap. And over a course, Larry, what was it, 3 years roughly, that we did inch up taxes to equal the funding level to where, you know, that was, as a matter of fact, that was the state law, that if the county commissioners merged the two systems, that the funding level had to be met of the highest of the numbers and the number of systems involved, which there was two systems involved, and we, by law, we had to come to the highest level, which was Burlington. So that was done. And how they spend the money, that's up to them.
Okay. Ben?
Yeah. Just an answer to Professor Felton. I speak highly of the school system all the time. I'm not around reporters all the time where it's reported, but I think very highly of our school system, and we're heading in the right direction. We've got a superintendent right now, and you're right. Those of you that talked about Dr. Bridges, he was down in Rock Hill to start with before he came up here, and my sister works in that system, and when we hired him up here, when the school board did, she called me and just jumped all over me. And I said, look, I didn't have anything to do with that. That was the school board. So a lot of good things going on. When we look at the supplement for teachers, We have continued in a deliberate way to increase it. It was increased to 7% last year. As this budget hopefully is passed tonight, I don't think it'll be a problem. It will be increased to 8%. We saw a slight increase in the teacher retention last year. So it's working. It's working. We're heading in the right direction. We're doing some good things, and we just need to continue to go in that right direction. And one other thing, I want to speak of what Lee had to say also, Mr. Isley. I've seen a couple people that live in eastern Guilford County that have sold their homes here in the last few months, Lee, and moved to Alamance County to get their kids in the school systems in Alamance because of the gang problems in eastern Guilford County. So.
Anything else?
Sure it wasn't the tax rate.
That too.
Several counties surrounding us asked voters this year to pass a 0.25% sales tax increase to help fund their budgets. And all of those initiatives have been defeated. And it's put some counties, Randolph County is in dire, going to be in dire predicaments because of that. And I think Guilford County will also be, especially with all the bond issues that passed over there. It's surprising to me that the sales tax issue failed. That could help support paying those bonds off. But this board chose not to put that initiative on the ballot and increase our budget with that income because I think we felt like we knew what the outcome would be here. So at the county manager had to take a pretty sharp knife to request that county departments made, and they took a real cut. At their expense, we were able to increase the school budget almost 9%, including the 1% supplement increase. The community college got basically what they wanted, other than some capital funding. But a lot of the other county departments got the same or less. So, and this was all because of the economic downturn that we're in and the projected shortfall in revenues. And it's with any budget on a yearly basis, it's a document of compromise between the staff and the commissioners and the citizens. And I never get what I fully want in it, and neither does any other commissioner get what they fully desire. But we have to craft something that can garner the majority vote. As Dan said, we are making progress in school funding, slow as it may be. And hopefully things turn, if the economic factors turn around the corner, then we can speed that process up. And I think business people really do pay attention to what the county spends on education. I talk to them a lot. I know who's a lot of times looking here and who's not looking here because of one reason or the other. But education does play an important factor in economic development. And I hope this board and those that are newly seated in November will always keep that in mind. As far as our fund balance is concerned, We recognize the fact that we have to be careful with the fund balance, and that's reflected in this year's budget. It is a decrease of roughly $1 million, I think, from what was allocated last year. It would be nice if the budget could be balanced without any allocation of fund balance, but that's going to either mean deeper cuts than we had this year to do that, which the schools would certainly have been devastated if we tried to do that, or tax increase to cover the difference. Now, it has been in most municipalities and county governments allocate some fund balance to balance the budget, and hopefully you don't have to use that because of lapsed salaries and normally a lot of times your expenses don't run what you've budgeted, and it covers the allocation for fund balance. But we are giving that increased importance each year in the budget process to get to where our accountant would like us to be, where it's zero allocation in the budget. But that is that's a lot harder to do than it is to say. But that's all the comments I have. I'll now entertain a motion on the budget.
Mr. Chairman, I'd make a motion that we approve the budget as recommended by the county manager.
Do we have a second?
I'd like to, before we go, and I'm going to support that vote, but before we finalize that, we've got so many. How many positions do we have frozen for 6 months? 50, what is it, 40 what?
48.
48. Can we come back after the first quarter of review of sales tax and property tax and just in general, just the, you know, have a review rather than wait 6 months?
Yes.
Because there's some positions here that I'm sure need to be filled. Some I'm sure we could wait. Some I'm sure we probably could do without all three of those. But I think 6 months is too long. So 3 months if we could come back and review that. And I'd like to ask what on travel allowance, we had. Are we going to really monitor that this fiscal year?
We cut it substantially again this year. We cut it last year's real substantial, and we cut it again fairly substantially this year. Yes, we will. I've been monitoring.
I know you have, and I just hope that we'll stay on top of that. And, so I just
want
to ask about those 2 points.
Do we have a second to Dan's motion?
Second.
Do we have a second? Any further discussion?
I'd like to make some comments.
Okay.
First comment. I would like to see us moving forward, and maybe the board next year, instead of across the board pay raises for county employees, to have a, because I didn't like it when I was teaching, absolutely not, and couldn't say anything about it and didn't say anything about it at that time, but I don't really think it's fair, because you have some people that work so hard and you have others that are there. You know it in teaching. We know it, and it's at everywhere, so it's not just any one place. I would like to see less of a cross-the-board pay increase, maybe 1 or 1.5%, but add to that, I would like to see the difference in that money being put in one pot, and these department heads do evaluations on their employees, make it a merit pay type basis. I know there are some employees that come in at 10 and leave at 3. Oh, by the way, take lunch too. Add to that, if you like, a no-cost time off, maybe 5 days or 7 days, where it doesn't cost the county. It's there for you. If you leave, then there's no monetary value in that. And I just want to throw that out. I appreciate the county employees. They're great. We have wonderful department heads. But just to kind of cut down on costs and not have a set pay increase, a certain percentage across the board, which I disagree with. So.
Okay. Any other comments before we go? If not, all in favor of the budget as proposed by the county manager, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Anything else? I want to thank you and your staff for the work that y'all did on the budget. Thank those in the audience for speaking and attending tonight's meeting.
Mr. Jordan looking out.
John, where are you living? You getting old.
I said, okay.
Orange County's taxes going to a dollar on the hundred.
Thank you, John. We still have some items to attend to on the agenda. Okay, next item on the agenda is the county manager report.
Mr. Chairman, the only thing I have is the county picnic has been rescheduled to May 28th from 11 till 2. As we do every year, Joyce, I'm sure we'll be contacting each of you to see if you will volunteer to help cook.
Okay. If you don't want to cook, you can serve, Ms. Vaughn. Exactly. We got something for you to do. I'll be calling you.
Thank you so much.
Okay. That's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Are we doing steaks? Okay. I mean, you know.
Yeah.
Steaks.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Next, we have the consent agenda. I'll make a motion that, unless there's an opposition, we approve items A through F. Is there a second?
Second.
Motion is second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Next, I think Mr. Lashley has something he wanted to bring up.
Yes. It seems like the state is trying to do away with paving the rural roads in our county. If y'all looked at your there's three counties that's come up with resolutions asking for that not to happen, that the state continue to support the roads that's in the county and not turn it over to us where we'd have to do it. And our money's going to the state, and they turn around and they should turn around and do what's right and maintain the roads that's in the county now. And there's three resolutions from three different counties, and I'd like to make a motion that we come up with our resolution of Alamance County supporting the same situation.
Okay. I'll second it. Have any discussion on it? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Any other announcements?
Yeah, three things, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to discuss with the board. The first one is the Jordan Lake Rules. This is going to end up costing the county money down the road. When you look at what it's going to do to farming, what it's going to do to building, I mean, this is going to be an expensive endeavor for all of us that live here in Alamance County. And we've got a couple of farmers here, Frank Bell and Henry Vines. But what I would like to see us do, and I'll make this in the form of the motion, is that we join in with the municipalities here in Alamance County, that we also allocate the $5,000 to go towards attorneys to see what direction we should take, and that we direct staff to join forces with the city governments that are opposed to this Jordan Lake venture rule.
I like that idea, but I don't want to see us put any county money in that situation. I think the
the county money is already being put in by the city. The cities are part of the counties.
The city residents pay county taxes also.
That's right. And they pay city property taxes, which is going to that fund. They don't need to be paying twice.
I'll leave a motion as I make it. Okay.
We do have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
What's the cost figure, though? I'm curious.
It's at $5,000.
$5,000.
Yeah, I support that. Yeah. Okay, we have a second. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Aye.
Okay, motion passes 4-1.
The second thing is, I know that we just approved in the budget for the employees a 2.5% cost of living increase. But inflation for this year is just over 4%. And I would like to make a motion to the board that we grant each employee here with the county 5 days off paid leave that will count as just like vacation, with the exception of if they do leave here during that time, they will not be compensated for it. So just an additional 5 days off paid leave. And I just throw that out for you in the form of a motion.
Yes, ma'am. I'll second that.
Can it be required that the days be taken non-consecutive? How personnel do you feel like that would
be? I think the department heads, commissioner, can work it so that they, and they have the discretion on vacation days, work it so that their staff is not overburdened. Well, they've got people.
I think that's got to be considered.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Is that Joyce? How about an employee that's been here 6 months? I mean, what?
Usually when an employee's been here for 6 months in the probationary period, they do not need to take vacation in that time frame. They can't take vacation until after they complete their probationary period. Unless when we recruit them, maybe they had something, a fire engagement or something, and the department head approves it upon recruitment. But typically what happens is they cannot take any vacation until they have successfully completed the 6 month probationary period.
I mean, should we put a limitation on this in any form or fashion, but new hires?
Sure,
you can.
Yes. What would you suggest?
I suggest that if we're going to, when I am in the hot seat, I suggest that we're going to do it. I think that it should not apply to new hires. And I think it should not apply to new hires.
So they believe the probation period?
I think it should apply to new hires, period.
So how long should they be here before it would apply?
I think it should apply to existing employees.
So I've been here a year, so.
I see what you're saying, the current employees, the ones that are here now.
Yes, yes. And I want my kudos at the end of the meeting.
That's good.
I just think we should apply to employees who are currently here. Yeah.
Okay, that's part of the motion.
Yes, sir.
Okay, any other discussion on that? This will have a no. Dollar cost to the county. Strictly just time off, okay.
Yeah.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
And the third thing is, Commissioner Vaughn has brought up a couple of times, and I think rightfully so, that we all always consider the sheriff's raise in the middle of a budget year rather than during the budget. And I think it's appropriate to do it on budget night. And what I'd like to recommend to the board at this time is a 5% pay increase effective July the 1st with another 5% effective January the 1st.
Just in the can we revisit it January 1st?
That'd be fine. You're saying 5% now, July 1st, and we revisit it, the other 5% July 1st. I mean, January 1st. That's fine. That'll be fine with me. That's my motion.
Is there a second to that?
Second.
Actually, a second. Any further discussion on that? Not hearing none. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries 5-0.
I think that's enough for me.
I would like to propose a second time that we set up a fund, a county fund, that anybody who wants to contribute any money, any additional money to go to that fund, tax fund, and it be turned over to the school system.
I think they can do that now, Bill.
Yeah, they can make a check out tomorrow.
Yeah. And they.
I'd like to say special fund. Let's put their mouth where put their money where their mouth is. You know, they come down here every single year and they want to raise taxes on everybody in the county, and let's give them a chance to pay that extra cost and extra taxes if they want to. Let's put them on the spot.
How about if we take that? Would you be okay if we take it under advisement and study it a little bit and see what the
legal aspect?
See what
it's legal. It's done in a bunch of counties, and it's legal. Is that not correct?
Quite frankly, I would have to check. I've never checked on that.
Okay. You will let us know.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I think I'm going to bang the gavel before I ask for any other comments.
Let me pass this article out to all of you. This is...
banging time.
Dan, I thought Dan was going to bring this up tonight. You know, we had mentioned performance-based budgeting for Davidson County.
Yeah.
Recognized heavily. This is an article that was in Popular Government. The authors were from the School of Government, faculty members specializing in local government administration, so forth and so on. And the title of the article was Rewarding Greater Accountability with Increased Managerial Flexibility in Davidson County. And I think the article is a couple of years old, as a matter of fact. And I had you a copy, fax to you, and I got everybody a copy here tonight. Just read it. Maybe during this year we can somehow break into some of this theory, because it seems to be working there and in other areas.
Okay. Should have banged that gavel, Larry.
Okay, any other comments?
I read this. I think it's a good thing. I really do. And they've really increased productivity through this, and it brings the customer service back to where it should be, where the customer, being the citizen, comes first in services, and that's where we need to be.
Right.
All right. Yeah, but thank you everyone for attending. The meeting's adjourned.
Oh, me, Bill.
Well, okay. All right.